that we understand, okay, let's put aside the government for the moment, let's put aside any kind of health claims or safety claims, that we can ourselves say that we are acting in good faith with due diligence. And I wrote about 12 months ago, I wrote an article in on the bovine. Are we destroying our own raw milk ruling in Ontario? And the reason was that there is cow share operations jumping up everywhere, and some of them operate really great, and some of them operating don't know what they're doing, not because they don't want to know, but because they just don't have the experience. And that's what we were trying to do, is to look at what is it actually that the judge ruled on, Kowarski, how, on what did he rule? He didn't rule on a brilliant argument, on a brilliant legal argument. No, what he ruled on was actually on 10 years, 15, 20 years of experience in respect to our farm, how to establish a safe raw milk production, and how we were able to basically present him with the fact what we have done over all these years. And so it was not something really brilliant we brought forward to the courts. What we simply brought forward was what we were doing on the farm and how we operated and so on. And that is what his ruling was based on. Now the question is, how do we want to go forward from here? Because there is a wave of demand for good products. And in our case, it is good milk. And how do we make sure that we protect ourselves, not necessarily against the dangers of raw milk, that's a given, but against that we get accused of being, how do you call it from a legal standpoint of view, negligent, how we actually bring people into the equation of raw milk. And the Western Price Foundation certainly is one critical, very critical element in this whole movement, and it's called movement. in this whole movement, because of the recommendations to look at that we need to get back to nutrient-dense foods. Nutrient-dense foods, there's many different things you can look at. Meat, for example. Liver, whatever. The only difference is that you can consume all the other products without restrictions by the government. So you can go in the supermarket, you can go wherever you want to go and get your liver fresh, and then it's up to you to do it. This is not the case with milk. And therefore, we need to look at that because the milk is so heavily regulated. I just came back in May from the Food Safety and Quality Conference in Prague. There was a whole day, a raw milk symposium. And guess what was so interesting? They didn't look at the issue of how dangerous milk is. At the whole raw milk symposium, they looked at the question, what is it that raw milk affects our health so positively? Yeah, safety was a sideline, completely a sideline. There was the chairman or the director of the raw milk association in Germany, which existed 100 years already. So they have a proven record of 100 years. And they wrote me for the trial 20 years ago, a letter that in the 80 years of existence, that was 20 years ago, in their 80 years of existence, they never had one single case of disease from the Raw Milk Association, from the farms which got certified by the Raw Milk Association. 80 years free of disease. I talked to him about listeriosis, E. coli, and so on, and he said, we have no problem with that. We have absolutely no problem with that. Okay? So It was a completely negligent, and they do, I don't know how many thousands of tests every year. However, there are certain standards which they are required to follow, and in order to guarantee that. And that is a little bit like, let's establish some kind of regulations that people drive on the right side of the road and not on the left side of the road. Okay, that's all what it is, so that we know where we're going. Before I announced this workshop here or this event here, I talked to Sally Fallon, who is the president of the Weston Price Foundation, and she is also the founder of the Weston Price Foundation. And I think we have to credit her for actually driving the raw milk movement right in the top agenda in right across North America. And it's one needs to understand even that the raw milk movement itself became now basically the leading cause for the food freedom movement in North America, almost more than the GMO movement, because the GMO movement is more a matter of knowing it, the effects we don't know yet, but with the raw milk we actually do understand what effects raw milk have on you personally, on your children, and on getting pregnant. I had people coming on the bus and ask, I can recommend, if you want to get pregnant, come on the blue bus. You don't need the blue pill, go on the blue bus. So it definitely has really, really interesting health effects, and I'm not necessarily here to promote the health effects of raw milk, because that is all you can do, actually, mostly figure it out yourself. The fact is, from the conference in Prague, that we had on the speaker panels, we had doctors from across Europe talking about this incredible miracle, where they're still trying to research why is raw milk so effective in preventing chronic diseases and child asthma and all these kind of things. They have the numbers. They have the numbers over there, and they cannot really get into it yet, because the research is all going towards, you know, the how you can heal yourself with drugs. So then I discussed the issue with Sally, and actually be starting a campaign to educate the chapter leaders of the Weston Price Foundation how to, when they recommend farmers for milk, what is the responsibility? What is their responsibility? It's so easy to say about, go here and get your milk there. There's somebody with raw milk. And that is what concerned me right from the beginning, that it is not raw milk itself which is so crucial. It is how raw milk is produced. You need to understand that 90% of the raw milk, and I say that in general, and that is where I totally agree with the government, 90% of the raw milk is contaminated with pathogens. Okay? These pathogens are Salmonella, Listeriosis, E. coli, what other goodies are in there?
Campylobacter.
Yeah. So we have all these goodies in the raw milk, and that has to do with how the milk is nowadays produced. So when you now have, and I had a lot of inquiries about raw milk, and from farmers who want to do the same thing. I had a high producing dairy farmer wanting to switch over. His cows give over 15,000 liters of milk. He wanted to stay in that kind of league of high production, and wanted to have a few cows beside, but want to continue the other thing. And I said, it doesn't work. Either you believe into it, because we're looking at a holistic management approach here. When we talk about food safety, it's not only about testing your milk and to make sure that you have sanitary conditions. It goes far deeper. And that, I think, is so difficult to try to make people understand, that the concept of the safety of raw milk is not a concept of sanitation and not a concept of testing. All these things are necessary after the fact. That means after the fact, after you know how to produce safe raw milk, that you can verify that your milk, in fact, is safe to drink, okay? And the other factor, which is really important to understand, is that testing raw milk is an insurance for your own sake. Not necessarily that you say, well, in order to that people don't get sick, but that you can actually pull out these results. And when you have a problem with the authorities, that you simply show them, these are my results. You show me the pathogens. They came with 25 armed officers on our farm. Okay, they raided us. They took over 500 liters of milk, over 20 liters of cream, I don't know how many pounds of cheese, whatever. And they sent them to the lab. The only thing they needed in order to convict me would have been to find pathogens in the milk. And they sent the stuff to the lab and they tested it and tested it and tested it and they couldn't find anything.
Except that it was raw milk.
Except that it was raw milk, okay? And that is what they ended up with, and just simply charging me with that I'm selling unpasteurized milk. But they could not prove to the judge in court that there was any problem with our milk because our milk was good. And that, I think, is a really important aspect one needs to understand. So, what do you do when there's so much pressure on this movement? First of all, you find that there's people jumping into the business, like everywhere. People jumping in the business, like with the organic, that you had people wanting to be organic, and then it turns out that these big food companies in the US, they have this certification where you can, you know, you are 1 year organic and then you can sell your milk as organic. And they had these CAFOs, you know what CAFOs are? Mm-hmm. CAFOs are these factory farms where they have 10,000 cows. So what they're doing is they're moving cows from the one herd into a smaller herd where they have a little bit of pasture and they only have to be there for 1 year and then they're organic. And then when the cow is not good enough, then they move it back into the big CAFO. So basically there is a total manipulation of the regulations in regard to the to what organic is, and they found that out, and there's an advocacy group in the United States which kind of watches a little bit what's going on there and unearthed these kind of problems, that organic milk is not necessarily organic because there are so many people know now how to get around these regulations in order to produce that and then cash in. And the same problem we're facing now here